from Ashland, Oregon, home of William Shakespeare and progressive politics, and broadcasting live from the Southern Oregon University Digital Media Center and the RVTV studio. It's the So Not So Late Night Glamour Dave Show, and recorded before a non-existent studio audience with a skeletal crew of certified public access producers. You can expect to see tonight's guests, whoever they may be, the Glamour Dave Comedy Players, and the Rogue Valley Public Access Orchestra. Now, here's your host, David Glamour Dave Nienow.
Hey there, Rogue Valley. Welcome back to the second half of the So Not So Late Night Glamour Dave Show. I'm your host, David Glamour Dave Nienow, and we are coming back with a new guest. We have Heather Ransom on, who is a sci-fi author based in Grants Pass, and so we're going to be talking to her about her books and the development of her stories. And once again, we have Anna Christie from Baby G Goat Milk Soaps serving as guest sidekick for the night. So, ladies, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you.
So, Heather, I just discovered you just like in this past week, seeing an article about you and your books in Southern Oregon Magazine. And I was in a crunch situation trying to get this week's show booked and got hold of you, and that's how you're here now. So,
it worked out.
So I thank you for coming on. I was really intrigued by the premise of your sci-fi novel. So talk a little bit about what your books are about and kind of the concepts in them.
Yeah, so what I've written is a trilogy. It's a young adult science fiction dystopian stories. And it actually takes place, the entire story takes place over 1 year of the main character's life.
Oh,
so
okay.
It's set about 125 years in the future, and all based on real science. I have been a science teacher. This is my 27th year teaching at South Middle School in Grants Pass.
Wow, that's first really 25, good.
Yeah, thank yeah. you. First 25 years I taught science yeah. and just loved it. So it's all based in real science, things that are really happening yeah. today. But the idea of the story is that in the future, there's a virus that goes through the planet and it starts to kill off all the plants. And so we are looking for a way to save humanity by creating modified chloroplasts to go into humans. So that whole idea of basic biology, right?
Right.
So we can take out the middleman. We no longer would have to eat plants. If we had chloroplasts in our bodies, we could photosynthesize. And the idea would be then that we would no longer have to eat plants.
Right.
Or animals that eat plants.
We would get our energy from the sun.
Get our energy directly from the sun. That's the idea mm-hmm. behind the stories.
Okay.
And so that is the future that it's based on. And it's based on things that are happening in the story when it talks about it. It's based on things that are happening relatively close to now. So within like the next 10 years would be when all of that starts happening. Then the book takes place 100 years after that. So the plants have started to come back on the planet, but we've continued this process. And in the book, they end up referring to the process as going green. So the idea of going green in the future is very different than going green right now.
Yeah. Yes.
So going green means that if you have the modified chloroplasts in your body, that you eventually, over time, would turn green.
Mm-hmm.
So your skin and your hair would turn green. I also have their eyes turn green, which actually wouldn't happen, but I just thought it'd be really cool if everybody had vibrant green eyes in the future. So the process, the plants start to come back, but they continue this process. So life in the future, everything is based on the color of your skin. You are either green or you're not green. And if you're green, you're in the contributing class.
Uh-huh.
And if you're not green, you're in the supporting class. And it makes it really easy because you can just look around and you know what class people are in and what types of things that they're doing. So everyone in the future, everyone's happy because everyone knows their place.
So is one class better than another class?
So
do the green want to be not green and the not green want to be green?
So the main character in the story is 18 years old. It is the week before spring break of her senior year of high school. So if you think about that time when you came back from spring break and all of a sudden everything's getting real, right?
Yeah, right, yeah.
So the idea is she is from a family who her dad is the CEO for one of the genetic corporations that's modifying chloroplasts to put into humans. And so she's always known that she would go green. Mm-hmm. In order to go green, it's an expensive process. It's a medical procedure, so it's expensive. You have to be able to pay for it. And you also have to go through a screening committee that has to approve your application to go green. So not everyone gets to go green. So, but she's known that she would always go green. And so the interesting thing for her is she ends up meeting someone who has chosen not to go green. And she's never met anyone before that if they had enough money and if they were smart enough and they could pass all the tests and they could go through the whole screening process, why would you choose not to better yourself? Because the idea originally was everyone who went green, the idea of the contributing class was now that they would no longer have to eat, they would have more time to devote to making the world a better place, right?
Right, okay.
So, and we all know that if you're wealthy, if you have lots of money, of course that's what you'll do. You're always going to be working to make the world a better place, right? Always.
Theoretically.
Yeah. So, the story is really about choices and consequences. The going green process is permanent. Once the chloroplasts are introduced to your cells, you can't get them out. So the story really becomes then a story about what happens if you make a choice that's permanent and then you decide you've made the wrong choice for you. Mm-hmm. And what do you do about that?
Yeah.
You have to be 18 years old. You have to be a legal adult to be able to go through the process in the story. And she has a late birthday, which is why she's one of the last people in her class. You know, it's April. Or it's end of March, beginning of April, you know, she really wants to go through this process. And in the opening chapter, she is in the middle of the process. So it is never an option for her not to go green. But what happens when you make that, when you make that choice and then maybe it wasn't the right choice for you?
I don't know about you, Dave, but I feel like we should be reading this book.
I think it's an interesting...
It sounds pretty... fascinating.
Yeah, I was really intrigued when I read the information about what your books were about, and just that very concept of people transforming their DNA and going through this process. I just thought, in one respect, I thought, well, that's actually kind of a cool idea, but there's also kind of like a scary factor to what the world would be like. You know, if that were to be available, you know, so.
Right. That's what's cool. It opens up the what if, like what if this happened? Plus, I like that it seems like it would be good read for adults as well as kids, that it kind of applies to both groups.
I think that the story, depending on where you're at in your life, you'll get something different from the story. So I have my publisher, Not a Pipe Publishing, they have said, you know, it's YA, it's 13 and up. But I have had younger students read it. There's nothing totally inappropriate in it that, you know, you couldn't have. I think the lowest discussion I've had it with is a fourth grader who was very science-minded. The issue would be if they understand the science that's in it. But I've had middle school and high school kids both read it, and they both come out with something very different, and adults then read it and come out with something even very different from that. Looking back, I think as adults, when we read a story like this, you look back and it's like when she talks to the guy who she thinks is so cool in the beginning of the story. And as adults, we're looking back going, oh, honey, nope. He is not what you think he is.
Yeah.
You know, but that idea of the high school drama and the things that are going through, that even in the future, these things are still the same. And working at schools for the past 27 years, I've seen things are still the same, you know? In terms of in the cafeteria, there's always this group sits here and this group sits there. And I mean, it's the way that it was when we were in school. And there's still some things that are there. One of the things that I do love about the story, going in and talking in classrooms, is that it gives kids a language. And especially like in middle school, beginning of high school, when kids are still, they're still developing their own ideas about things, it gives them a way to talk about some of the current issues that are happening right now in our own society without having to actually talk about those specific things. They can talk about, well, why would someone, you know, it's so ridiculous that she thinks that he isn't as good of a person because he's not green. And I'm like, well, why? Well, because your skin color wouldn't have anything to do with how smart you are. Oh, really? And we start having some great conversations that are totally student-led. where they can talk about things, and but we can talk about green and non-green.
Yeah.
So it's a safe way to talk about some things, especially for kids who aren't, maybe they don't feel exactly the same way their parents do, or they're exploring their ideas of how do they feel about things. Mm-hmm. And so it gives them a way to talk about things, some safe language to use.
You can take the concepts and the things that are happening in the book and then bring them into reality.
Absolutely.
That's powerful. Yeah.
And then the second book, so the first book is called Going Green, and then the second book is called Greener. Yeah. And it is, the second book is the same character, Calissa.
Right.
She is now just finishing her first term of college in the second book. And this story really is about, the idea behind it is it's, when things are going good and you're happy, it's easy to be a good person. When everything yes. around you is good, it is easy to be a good yes. person. But when things start to go bad, and things in your life get difficult, and I throw about everything at her that could happen in a story, what kind of person are you going to choose to be? Because that is your choice. And so it's really that idea of looking at yourself and what are you going to choose to be? Who are you going to choose to be?
So these are much deeper than just stories. There's a lot going on in there, just about life lessons.
Yeah. About 6 years ago, I got to listen to Richard Peck speak, and he's an incredible novelist. And one of the things that he said that really stuck with me, he said, if you're going to write YA novels, middle grade and YA novels, he said, you need to really think about what you're writing because they should be survival guides for tomorrow's adults. So what yes. we're writing today for youth should be the survival guides for tomorrow's adults. So I think that books should have more to them.
Yes.
They should have a good story, and it should be fun, and it should be exciting to read, and you shouldn't want to put them down, but it should also make you think about your own life and how those things apply, and some of those bigger questions along the way.
Well, that's I think that's an important element of some of the world's best literature, isn't it? Is that there's multiple layers of elements to the best literature out there that stand the test of time.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Right?
And so that, you know, you read something and you can read it multiple times and glean various layers of ideas when something really is a quality story and quality writing.
Yeah, I agree.
So I feel like these books are amazing. I haven't read one yet, but just listening to the background of the book.
Thank you.
So the book is based, it's a science fiction book, so there's mm-hmm. science in it. And mm-hmm. she's been a science teacher for 27 years, so you can imagine that all that is in the book. And then it's a young adult book, and she's worked with elementary and junior high school kids for the last 27 years and gotten their feedback and yep. stories and input and questions and kind of built that into the book. And then when we were talking earlier, you were talking about all the revisions that you made through the process of getting your book published.
Absolutely.
So talk a little bit about that, because that was yeah. amazing.
So originally this story was just a story. It was a story that I've told to my classes for years and years and years. And in 2013, I had a student in my class, her name was Kennedy Beck. And she said, Mrs. Ransom, you have told us that we can do anything we set our minds to. How come you haven't made this story into a book? She kind of called me out on the carpet. I was like, well, that's a really good question. And so I thought, you know, how hard can it be to write a novel? So, telling a story and writing a story are two very different things.
Yeah.
And so it took me about 3 months to write the story, which is really a very quick time. But remember, this is a story I've been telling for years and years and years. And it took 3 months to write it, and then it took me 3 years to revise it. I can't even tell you how many drafts I went through, how many rejection letters, letter mm-hmm. after letter after letter. I was saying originally the very first person that I pitched it to was an agent who told me that the book would never sell because our society is not ready for people who are green, who are not aliens. And okay. I told her, as a science teacher, we've never actually proven that aliens are green, so
yeah, that's
I felt okay with the story. She might be wrong in her opinion, since I didn't feel like she was exactly spot on with the whole alien thing. So, but it took a long time, and it's actually been a really great process for my kids at school, too, to see me go through all of that and to talk about
yeah.
it. You know, that you can't give up on your dreams yes. because one person tells you. You
That's
can't
right.
give up on your dreams because 20 people tell you that it's not going to work out, because you never know when the next time might be the time that everything happens.
That's right. Yeah.
That your dreams are going to come true. And if you give up one time short, just one more time, you might have got there.
Yeah. And if you give up, you'll never make it.
That's right.
And you took all of those rejections and you made it better, bit by bit. You took the input and you revised the book and then shot it out there again. And then took that input, revised the book, shot it out there again.
Kid after kid. Yeah. I have about 100 kids that read for me that have read in the past between 13 to 18 years old, and then several adults too. As well, I have some great friends that are incredible editors that have read for me as well. But each time reading, and kids will call you on, they call you on everything. Yeah. They're like, nope, she would not say it like that, or nope, he would not do that in the story.
Yeah.
And they call you on everything. So it was a really wonderful experience, also working with all of those teens.
Yeah, and I would think that that those kids that you're teaching and that you're interacting with, that they're watching you go through this process, pursuing the dream, pursuing the idea. It has to be, you have to have a positive impact on those kids, because they're seeing you go through the effort of pursuing the fulfillment of that dream, and they see that you've achieved your success, and that has to be an inspiration to them.
I hope so. I hope so. And it's really great. It's fun to sit with the kids and talk with them about the stories, and then to hear their stories. I mean, there's some kids that just have amazing things, and that you don't have to be an adult to write stories. You don't have to be an adult to tell incredible stories and to start writing your stories now. I wish I would have started writing stories now when I was younger, but I always just wanted to tell stories. But that idea of writing them down and being able to share them with others.
And so you obviously love learning and expanding your knowledge and going for the next step. And so now, not just novels, but you're getting into screenplays.
Screenplays. I'm learning this summer. I started working on learning screenwriting, which is as different from writing a novel. As hard as it was to learn to write the novel and to go through the format and to really make sure you develop characters and arc and plot and theme and all of those things through your story, screenwriting is a whole new ball game again. But I think it's good to keep pushing yourself and keep learning to do new things and keep trying to move forward and try new things. There's so much out there, so much to do.
Dave.
Yes, God, Mike.
It's time for the Glamour Dave Wheel of Mystery.
Ah, there it is, right there behind us. Yeah. Okay. So Heather, you just let us know when you want the wheel to stop and we'll see what happens next.
Stop.
Okay, so we can toot our own horn. Let's see here. Well, these horns were already been used the last segment. So I got a fresh set of harmonicas.
Oh, excellent.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
It's time to toot your own harmonica.
That's right, So these have not been used at all. This is the first time they're being used on the show.
Okay.
Excellent.
Yeah, okay. So let's see how these sound.
All right.
I don't even know if it's turned the right way. That's where
the holes are there, Anna.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, this became the awkward moment.
that's for sure. Yeah.
Guess what? Our guest gets a second spin.
Okay, cool.
Excellent.
All right. So let's go ahead and say stop when you're ready. We'll see what happens next.
Stop.
We have a joke.
Excellent.
Okay. So I have in here envelopes full of stupid jokes. Okay. I did some serious research to find these really stupid jokes. So we'll see what the stupid joke is of the moment. All righty. What kind of bagel can fly? A plain bagel. I told you, that's like high quality. This is high quality as it gets on this show, man.
I can use that one at school on Monday.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, take it to the kids.
Yeah, you can take that with you.
Excellent, thank you.
And report that back to your kids at school. I'm sure they'll appreciate that.
Dave.
Yes, God, Mike.
That might have been the awkward moment.
Yeah, well, yeah, this a lot of the stupid comedy I do is all very awkward, so... So where are we at in the time, God Mike?
Dave.
Yes. Yes, God Mike.
Dave.
Yes. I'm waiting for an answer.
10 minutes into the show, Dave.
Okay. Well, this is a great time for our musical guest, Buddy Paprock, to come up and perform one of his original songs. So thank you, Buddy, for coming on the show.
Yeah, happy to be here.
Yeah, he is applying for the role of the Public Access Orchestra here on the show.
This song's kind of an honest song, but it's about love. I've been dancing on a thin line, but I can't ever seem to be making up my mind. And though it may be detrimental to my health, I'd rather feel all the pleasures and the pains of a world that's real, we seem to want to escape from. But all around me I see heaven, we cover with hell, but I want to embrace it, I don't want to erase it. And I know that it could get a little ambiguous, used to this, confused in this surrogate bliss, but you want to see right through it. And once you do, you can't refuse it, cause the truth is just the truth, and I choose the love. Ooh, what you gonna choose? I feel your love arms and lift my head, close my eyes and get ready for the rain. I'm ready for all your loving. Drain all the hate in my heart instead of the blood from yours. Yeah, I just wanna live in love. Lately I've been playing with the big flame, I didn't get burned, but I learned from a little pain. Yeah, eager to learn myself, eager to stumble and fall, make mistakes, eager to face the things that scare me. But I know that all I really gotta do is show you some love to get you to come to your senses. No one I sense this, but sense this world is coming through wolves, just how to pretend it, that we're better than this. But I wanna believe it, cause I know the pain that I feel. We all got a little bit of the same stuff within us. Ooh, 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 ooh. What you gonna choose? Ooh. I feel your love storm coming. Open up my arms and lift my head, close my eyes and get ready for the rain. I'm ready for all your loving. Drain all the hate in my heart instead of the blood from yours. Yeah, I just wanna live in love. Yeah, I just wanna live in love. I just wanna live in love. I just wanna live in love.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, buddy.
Got to make it kind of relevant to your book, maybe, you know,
like
on the
it,
natural
yeah.
scale.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. Yeah. All righty. Well, we thank Buddy for that wonderful performance. And most likely after his appearance here, he'll get overbooked and won't be able to come back on the show for a while. So I will have to continue to search for a musical act to play the role of the Public Access Orchestra here on the show.
It's one of the drawbacks of being so popular.
Yeah. Yes, God, Mike.
Never mind, Dave.
Okay. All right.
Wait, Dave.
Yes.
You have 3 minutes left, Dave.
Okay. All righty. 3 minutes to kill.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you have any more books coming up after this?
So my first book, Going Green, is out. Came out in 2017, and then Greener came out in 2018, and the third book, the final book in the trilogy, will be out March 10th of 2020.
Okay.
So it is, that's the next release.
March 10th, upcoming book.
Yeah.
Mark that down.
Yes. Okay, so now this is planned from the outset to be a trilogy, but if the if the excess exposure created by the So Not So Late Night Glamour Dave show causes a major surge in sales.
Yes.
Right? And, you know, after particularly after your interview goes viral online, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Then what are the odds that you would be forced to then to expand beyond the original trilogy and continue onward with additional books in the series?
I've talked with my publisher a little about that. In the third book, there's a journal that they find, and they read these journal entries, and the journal is written in 2030. And so we've talked about going and back and writing that story from those characters' perspectives. And it ends up being relatives of the people that are in the story, the main characters in the story. And so there's a possibility there. And I had one of my editors then say, oh yeah, this is the end of this trilogy. And I know why. Because now you're going to write another trilogy from the person that we find out is really the bad person in all of this. You're going to write it from her viewpoint this time, right?
Yeah.
So writing companion novels. So maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe there's options.
I hadn't really thought of that, but she would be a wonderfully evil person to tell her story from the beginning. So that might be a possibility.
It'd be entertaining.
Yeah.
So
that might be it. But Going Green and Greener, these are available on Amazon. They are available at Barnes & Noble. They're available at your local bookstores. So
they're at the local Barnes & Noble in Medford, because that's where I've seen them before.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you're interested, you know, check it out.
Yeah.
And they are also available to download a downloadable version
the
on
e-book.
The e-book, if you're an e-book reader as well.
And up and coming, the audiobook.
Yeah, the audiobook, that's the next the next venture. When the third book comes out, then I'm hoping that we'll get all three out on audio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, all right, cool.
Absolutely.
Well, I really thank you for coming on the show.
Absolutely, thank you for having me.
And exploring your stories, I think it's a really cool, a lot of cool concepts that I find exciting. So I'm going to be sure to pick them up and read through them.
Excellent.
I think this would be also, you know, eventually get these turned into, you know, some movies or, you know, oh, we're having a wrap up? Okay, well, I want to thank my crew for all the wonderful help. I want to thank Anna for being my guest sidekick. Thank Heather for coming on. Thank Victoria Sofitel and her fiance for being on the past show segment. So this wraps it up for tonight, Road Valley, and we will see you next time.